All right, let me thank all of you first of all for coming to our roughly monthly seminar. And a reminder, as always, that this will be recorded. It's on the record. And please make sure your cell phones are off or muted. I've done now my job for the day. We're very pleased and honored to have Wilmot James here, our friend and colleague. He's an internationally recognized expert in global health security. He's currently serving as a visiting professor of political science and non-clinical pediatrics at Columbia University. Today, we're going to focus on the role of communities in minimizing biological risks in complex environments, including specifically countries that have been destabilized by war or regional conflict. I might say that last year at the Munich Security Conference, NTI hosted a tabletop exercise that had these elements in it. Pandemic, I won't say too much of how it all generated, but in a country suffering conflict, and the idea was to look at how the public health and humanitarian and security communities would or would not be able to work together in this kind of a complex environment. I will just say it was eye-opening. You can guess of which sign, and you will be right, unfortunately. Wilmot was a member of parliament in South Africa, an opposition spokesman on schools, trade, and health. He served as chairman of the South African Democratic Alliance between 2010 and 2016. He's the author or editor of 17 books, including Biotechnology and Health, South Africa's Aspirations in Health-Related Biotechnology, and another, quite different, on Nelson Mandela in his own words. So Wilmot does span this interesting space in his very distinguished career. He's taught at many leading universities, and now at Columbia, he's teaching a course on global health security and diplomacy. As you know, I think this audience knows, NTI has a very significant effort in biosecurity generally. And I just want to say that, and led by Beth Cameron, I should say led ably by Beth Cameron. Privately, we say some other things, but you know. The program is really, I think, getting great traction. Just last week, there was a paper published. There are copies out there for those of you who want this and other papers. But this was just last week with the World Economic Forum looking at issues of DNA synthesis and how one might address some of the risks there. That's also leading up to say that I think the program is very effective because it also has outstanding advisors like Wilmot, who is really a very, very important colleague for us, working on the global biosecurity dialogue. He was instrumental, really, in helping guide the global health security index and in general, our efforts to reduce risks from modern biotechnology. He's been instrumental to our regional biosecurity initiative in Africa, and that has been done in close partnership with Dr. John Kangazong, who is here in the front row today. We're very pleased to welcome him as well. And he directs the Africa Centers for Disease Control and Prevention. So John is also on NTI's advisory group for the biosecurity program. So again, I think we have a great team and we have a great bunch of advisors who are willing to help us have impact in this area. So, Wilmot, we look forward to hearing from you now on battling insecurity, mistrust, and disease. Are we capable of reining in epidemics in complex environments? After Wilmot's presentation, we will go to a Q&A session with all of you. Wilmot.
So thank you very much to Secretary Muniz for his very generous introduction to me. I'm very grateful that you've come to this lecture, which has the title of Insecurity, Mistrust, and Disease, Reining in Epidemics in Complex Environments. And I thought about this question after reading Yuval Noah Harari's Homo Deus, where he, in the first paragraph of his book, says that humanity has developed the means and the technology, the systems and the people to reign in war, epidemics, and he called it the plague, and famines. And the question was, is that true or not? And I wanted to look at where it is difficult to do that. And I refer here to complex environments. Now, all environments are in some way or the other complex. So in the literature presently, there is this really interesting concept of a wicked problem. And the wicked problem refers to a problem that cannot be solved very easily, because in the case of epidemic outbreaks, the co-evolution of the host and the human immune system and the pathogen, and that evolution process being both co-determined and not running at the same speed. So you can't easily speak about reigning in epidemics. So that's what prompted me to write this. What I'm going to do is deal with three topics. First, I'm going to talk about war and epidemics. I'm going to talk about health leadership in weak states. And I'm going to talk about what I call a new species of trouble, which is about biological risks. I will end the talk with a series of recommendations, speaking largely as a politician then, about what we're going to do about this problem. I'd like to start off, though, with a dedication. And the dedication is to somebody by the name of Sheikh Umar Khan, who was an expert in the clinical care of viral hemorrhagic fevers, and who died at the age of 39 in Kailahun, Sierra Leone, on June the 29th, 2014. Dr. Khan led Sierra Leone's Ebola response. He served as a physician in charge of the Kanema government's hospital Lassa fever program and saved more than 100 lives before he himself perished as a result of an infection. Jennifer Dawn, who is co-leader with somebody called Victoria Rosner at Columbia University's Nurse Leadership and Pandemics Oral History Project, interviewed Josephine Findu-Salu, who's a public health nurse, on how traumatic his death was for those who worked with him. This is what she said. He was sitting right in front of his boots, sitting in a rubber chair, and the IV fluid was hung on him. The drip was turning, and he was sitting in the chair. Immediately he saw me, he started crying, and I also started crying. Then the lady there, the Doctors Without Borders doctor, said, "No, don't cry. If he's crying, you are crying, so it's okay. You said greetings." And so I left. I left on Monday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and Monday again, and then he passed away. This was somebody that has given us courage, somebody that has been talking to us, you know, she says. And then he has lost his life. I am just a nurse. That man has died with all the expertise in hemorrhagic fevers, and now he's dead. So I said, I'm going to leave this job. I am going home. I will no longer work there. Then at night again, they called me, matron, nurse so-and-so is dead. And I said, what can I do? I said, I will not go there. But when they called me, I went there again. I went there, she said. Now, Dr. Khan would be the last person who wished to be solely acknowledged for his extraordinary devotion to the central creed of the Hippocratic Oath, to save lives and to promote health. Of the nearly 17,000 cases of Ebola viral disease in Guinea, Liberia, and Sierra Leone during the 2014 to 2016 outbreak, 600 of those was among healthcare providers, and half of them died during that period. The outbreak also claimed the lives of doctors, and nurses and technicians from Mali, Nigeria, Spain, and the USA. The account given of Dr. Khan's death told by Josephine Salu illustrates some key features of what happened there. Dr. Khan was the only expert in all of Sierra Leone in viral hemorrhagic fevers. He was intimately knowledgeable about the diabolical characteristics of the virus. He was likely quietly terrified, did not show it because he understood his role as a leader, placed his life at risk every time he treated someone, and as a result, inspired through sheer example others like Josephine Salu to do the same. I'm haunted by the courage of her words when she said, "I will not go there, but when they called me, I went there again." There can be, in my view, no greater courage than to put one's life on the line for strangers. It is the ultimate act of human altruism. And I wanted to start my talk tonight with a tribute to all those who do so every day across the globe in service of medicine's ultimate calling. It is also to remind us, if any reminder is needed, what the purpose is of, what the moral purpose is of our projects. So, in early 2019, the Africa Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, the Africa CDC, convened a meeting of the Partnership for Biosafety and Biosecurity in Gabon to help work on that piece of the threat that took Dr. Khan and his colleagues and their lives, and to help minimize the risk of it happening again. It was the second meeting of the Africa CDC partners, and the partners are the Nuclear Threat Initiative, the Atlanta-based CDC, Global Affairs Canada, the U.S. Department of Defense's Threat Reduction Agency, and the Open Philanthropy Project, in what is a continent-wide effort to improve biosafety and biosecurity in the 54 African countries. The first meeting was held in Johannesburg in June 2019 to cover the South African region. Further meetings for West, East, and North Africa will be held during this year. Now, Gabon is an oil-rich, francophone country located on the Atlantic Ocean coast of Equatorial Africa. Historians of medicine will remember it as the place where Albert Schweitzer and Aline Breslau Schweitzer established their hospital in the small town of Lamberine on an island on the mouth of the Ogooi River in 1913. Because of the oil, Gabon's per capita income is four times that of most African countries, but strong inequality of income means that more than 500,000 of its 1.7 million people live below the poverty line. Located on the equator, it is hot, as you know, and it is a malaria zone, and we had to take the dreaded anti-malarials, suffering slightly, to stave off a much worse possible fate. Gabon houses one of only two maximum containment biosafety level 4 laboratories on the African continent. The other is in Sandringham, Johannesburg, located at South Africa's National Institute for Communicable Diseases, or NICD. Both of these laboratories are authorized to handle Ebola, Marburg, Crimean Congo hemorrhagic fever viruses, and other extremely dangerous pathogens. Having this facility is likely why Gabon was selected to be the headquarters of the Central Regional Collaborating Center of the African Center for Disease Control. The other member states of the RCC are Burundi, Cameroon, the Central African Republic, Chad, Congo, the Democratic Republic of the Congo, Equatorial Guinea, and Sao Tome and Principe, together making up one of the most volatile regions in the world. It is a testing ground. It is a testing ground for managing epidemic outbreaks in the most forbidding of circumstances. The Atlanta-based CDC has recorded at least 27 Ebola outbreaks in Africa. Health professionals have accumulated considerable knowledge about how to contain it, including in remote areas. The reason why the 2014 to 2016 West African outbreak was spiraled out of control was that the Zaire Ebola virus strain was new to that region, devastated by history of blood and diamond wars. The DRC is currently battling an enduring outbreak of the same viral strain, but this time it has the advantage of a vaccine in hand. But the volatility of the region, colleagues, is a barrier to the success of a fairly well-oiled epidemic management operation. 3,393 cases have been registered, 2,235 deaths have occurred, and 1,222 survivors are under one or the other form of clinical care. The epidemic has not burnt out, and the understandable concentration of resources to fight Ebola has resulted in a broader immunization neglect, creating fertile grounds for what the WHO regards as the world's worst measles outbreak in recent times. 310,000 measles cases have been reported, and 6,000 people have died. Now, one cannot easily contain an epidemic in circumstances of war. There are, as you know today, three large theaters of war in Afghanistan, Syria, and Yemen. There are a number of smaller scale wars, most of which are concentrated in Africa. As noted, of these, the Democratic Republic of the Congo stands out as the most volatile one, having ongoing conflicts on its northern border with the Central African Republic and South Sudan, and especially on the Kivu Eastern border shares with Uganda, Rwanda, Burundi, and Tanzania. The latter area is home to scores of combatants whose motivations range from plunder, ethnic and proto-nationalist self-defense, and regime change. An estimated 1.6 million people have been displaced. New York University's Congo Research Group estimates that there are 134 armed groups operating in the region. And that is the region that we are talking about, around the Great Lakes area. Most of the armed groups, feel less than 200 fighters each, in numbers reflecting the DRC's inability to exert its authority and its governance over a region that is five times the size of Germany, most of it covered by equatorial forests and populated by 5 million people. Now, the Global Health Security Index, developed by the NTI, by the Nuclear Threat Initiative, under Beth Cameron's guidance and leadership, the Johns Hopkins University Center for Health Security, and the Economist Intelligence Unit, which was released in October of last year, included an assessment of the overall risk environment and country vulnerability when it comes to biological threats. A key vulnerability indicator is political and security risk in that index. And that index established that 13 of the 21 most at-risk countries are all in Africa, most of them concentrated in Central and the Horn of Africa, as well as the Sahel. The Fragile State Index defined all of the African countries on this list as being on alert, on high alert, and on extremely high alert when it comes to risks and hazards. Certainly, as the DRC state has no physical presence on the eastern border, it leaves therefore a vacuum that is filled by the 134 armed groups active in the region. Now, this is a problem that the health community in the area cannot and cannot be expected to solve because it's a political problem. War disrupts the delivery of and hampers access to social and health services to the extent that those services exist. War changes the priority of governments. War and conflict create unusual circumstances for pathogens to find gaps, and pathogens are wily in the health security infrastructure of any nation. War, famine, and pure nutrition are related evils affecting the immunological resilience of a population. War traumatizes a people, it renders them fearful of strangers and unsurprisingly distrustful of the warriors and militia men and women who seek out opportunities to commit unspeakable crimes, often against them. As we have witnessed many times over, a people lose faith in their governments when their safety and security cannot be guaranteed. To deal with the challenge, the World Health Organization has established a 40-person strong operation support and logistics team that works to solve the distribution problems of delivering medical and non-medical supplies to strategic hubs. Operating in such a vast area is risky and complicated, as poor roads and undulated terrain adds to the logistics challenge. 17 million gloves, over 2 million surgical masks, 109,000 gowns, and over 200,000 doses of Ebola vaccine thus far have reached their intended beneficiaries through this operation. The latter using a so-called super thermos technical innovation that has been funded by the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation to keep the vaccine at the right cold chain temperature. OSL, this body, also rebuilds torch health facilities. You know how many facilities have been burnt. They provide sanitation and hygiene equipment, and they also drill boreholes. They handle patient waste. They provide for safe and dignified burials, which are all critical parts of the effort to curtail any virus. But the WHO and other health agencies operating in the area, UNICEF is responsible for child health, the Africa Center for Disease Control, Doctors Without Borders, can only go so far. There are political dimensions to what it is they do, but their mission are to serve the health of nations. They are public agencies with a health mission. To enable them to do their work requires a political solution crafted by the United Nations, the African Union, and the regional bodies and the relevant domestic governments. The context for framing such a solution is changing and changing rapidly on the African continent. In October of 2019, 43 of Africa's 54 heads of state attended a Russia-Africa summit at the Black Sea Resort of Sochi, co-chaired by Vladimir Putin of the Russian Federation and Abd al Fattah al-Sisi of Egypt. An exceptional paper, the Johannesburg-based Brentus Foundation's Greg Moles, recorded that the meeting was a critical step in forging Russia's relationship with African elites, involving military engagements, commercial contracts, and a growing involvement in domestic political affairs on the continent. In his speech at the summit, Putin pushed for more trade, pushed his debt for development swap programs, and he claimed that they come with no preconditions. Moles observed that Russia is expert, as we know, in hybrid warfare, mixing conventional and unconventional weaponry, tactics that have been battle-tested in Ukraine and Syria, with an emphasis on rapid preemption without long mobilization, expeditionary movement, and in electronic warfare, the military aspect is but one of the instruments of a nationalist Russia poised to employ. He wrote, China is on a different trajectory to Russia to achieve world power, but it is no less a benign influence in Africa, giving both those countries tendencies to make transactional deals with elites without regards to human rights and democratic development, the latter empirically both strongly associated with economic development. Moles records that in his 2019 testimony before the Senate Armed Forces Committee, the then head of the U.S. Africa Command, Thomas Waldhauser, noted, and I quote, "the harmful influence of non-African powers on the continent." Both the general and his successor, Stephen Townsend, spoke of the malign influence of China and Russia. The UK Chief of Defence Staff, Sir Nick Carter, observed that we are moving towards, and I quote, "a global playing field characterized by constant competition and confrontation with increasingly assertive and aggressive states, utilizing techniques below the threshold of what we normally would call conventional war, all of which is overlaid by the threat of terrorism from violent extremist organizations." Russia's short-term strategy in Africa is to prop up dictators, to fiddle with elections, to sell arms, and to push their energy solutions. This is appealing to some African elites who are not interested in strengthening African democracies. The approach puts them at odds with a vast majority of Africans who routinely prefer democracy to other forms of government in polls, not least since the development record is much better than the record of authoritarian alternatives. But the United Kingdom today is diplomatically invisible on the continent, except for its hurried efforts to seal post-Brexit deals, while the US's approach unnecessarily risks internationalizing local conflicts. Changing this will require sustained Western engagements, and it cannot be a question of suits coming in and out over 2 or 3 days. A revised and perhaps a new approach to security in Africa is needed. The Global Health Security Index, one of its main recommendations, is that the United Nations Security Council urgently convene a series of meetings aimed at developing rapid response capabilities, strategies, workforce development, and the protections necessary for health workers for outbreaks that originate in or spread to countries with high political and security risks. In the case of the DRC, an emergency heads of state summit called by the UN Secretary General involving the countries with an immediate material interest in establishing peace in the region. And I don't say this lightly because it's a very complex environment. And with a political will to dilute, to contain, and even begin to break the vested interest in war making that has emerged in the course of time. Those countries include the DRC, Uganda, Rwanda, Burundi, Tanzania, South Sudan, Central African Republic, on the southern border, Zambia, and the southwestern border, Angola, as well as the Congo. Resolution 2348 of 2017 provides the authority for the current UN mandate in the Democratic Republic of the Congo. Since 1999, $8.7 billion have been spent to fund the UN peacekeeping effort in the DRC. As of October 2017, the total strength of the UN peacekeeping troops in the DRC is approximately 18,300. The UN presence should be upscaled, in my view, partnerships recalibrated, and be sub-headquartered in the region where the DRC government is the weakest and where the militias operate. The second part of my talk deals with health leadership in weak states. And you would know that disaster response is normally a public sector effort. But the private sector and the non-governmental sector are critical partners in the enterprise. Only governments typically have the constitutional authority, they have the reach, and they have the budgets to intervene at scale in the face of threats to public health, assisted by continental and all global agencies, as the case may be. When governments fail to intervene, because they, for whatever reason in their history, lack the leadership, lack the people, lack the systems, lack the technology, and lack the budgets to act. Communities and citizens are left to work it out for themselves. When the threat is new, and when it is fearsome, like Ebola or Zika, communities plunge into panic. In low-trust environments, and we're dealing mostly with low-trust environments, where citizens have no faith in the state, social breakdown and tragedy is almost inevitable. Those who take the clinical lead and are among the first to be exposed during an epidemic outbreak are the health professionals and workers. During the West African Ebola outbreak of 2014-2016, the death rate of physicians, nurses, and health workers was particularly high, as I noted, because the pathogen was new to the region and the health systems were weak as a result of war and as a result of serial underinvestment in the health systems in those countries. In his article in The Lancet, Andrew Green reported that, as I noted before, 17,000 cases of EVD in Guinea, Liberia, and Sierra Leone were recorded, and 600 have been among health care providers. Now, for all their valiant efforts, both in West Africa and presently in Central Africa, for all their valiant efforts, health workers have been rewarded with stigma. Nurses and community health workers, those who were more embedded in communities, were singled out in particular. Elizabeth Lamour of the Sierra Leone Ministry of Health told us that during, and I'm quoting, the Ebola outbreak, the community was against the nurses and the health workers that are in the hospital. I remember, she said, in one of the training sessions, one of the nurses testified that when they waited for a vehicle, the drivers would not, and I quote, not take them because they think they are carriers of the disease. They don't want to be infected by them, so they will not take them. Nurses were asked to get out of their homes, she relayed, especially those who were rent-paying. They would ask them out because the landlords don't want them to bring the disease into their homes. The community people, she continued, were not convinced about Ebola initially. There's no Ebola, there is no Ebola, was the outcry. These nurses and health workers are liars, they said, a local woman screamed from the rooftop. And the whole market in that town went into chaos. The whole village converged to go and burn the hospital. And we're talking here, in this case, the Kanema government hospital. This story has been repeated over and over again in the DRC. They said they want to burn down the hospital. They want to kill every nurse. They were saying, you kill one nurse, we'll give you 1,000. So the police, the military came and dispersed them, they told us, all of them. They sent some tear gas, she said. It was so terrible, you know. We were scared. It was just like that. It was not easy. It was a bitter lesson learned very well. When the more recent Ebola outbreaks occurred in the DRC, the WHO, UNICEF, and the International Red Cross and Red Crescent put together a highly sophisticated community engagement strategy. The goal was the creation of a community-level preparedness framework with the following objectives. First, to proactively and timelessly communicate about Ebola and its prevention and control through the media, through social media, and interpersonally. Second, to ensure that the population and frontline health workers had access to key life-saving information to enable them to make informed decisions about how they should protect themselves, their families, and their communities. Third, to engage in active dialogue with community influencers, as they are called, people who have moral authority in a community, networks and stakeholders regarding the spread of the Ebola viral disease, through active listening to community concerns and to promote awareness on EVD and safe practices. Fourth, to build capacities at international, national, and subnational levels to support effective readiness and preparedness, and finally, to incorporate all other pillars of the response as support for the overall preparedness strategy. With the vaccine in hand, working in collaboration with the DRC's health authorities, the administration of the plan went well, except in the areas where public authorities had no presence and where militia groups, especially in the Kivu area, filled the vacuum and put local communities at the mercy of banditry and war. To date, there has been more than 300 attacks on frontline health workers. Speaking at a public event in Geneva, the WHO's Mike Ryan said that in his 25 years of humanitarian work, violence carried out deliberately against health workers and hospitals had never been, he said, so bad. WHO DG Tedros Adhanom Ghebreyesus has shown exemplary leadership by repeatedly visiting areas affected by the violence, as has right on the front lines, and has the leadership of UNICEF, Doctors Without Borders, the Red Cross, the African Center for Disease Control, and philanthropies like the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and other civic bodies. Now, critical to success in the regions or areas of the world where governments have little to no presence are non-governmental organizations, civil institutions, or personalities that carry the trust of local communities. In the case of the DRC, special mention must be made of faith-based leadership. Religious institutions represent the people in affected DRC areas and have a deep reach and extensive membership that government and both government and non-governmental agencies simply do not have. Trusted by local communities and citizens, religious leaders can persuade citizens not to hide suspected victims and to respect the instructions of the local Ebola teams. The Wellcome Trust published the results of 140,000 strong survey undertaken in more than 114 countries and found that vaccine trust was highest in countries where preventable infectious diseases still spread and where religious or other respected institutions or personalities clearly supported vaccine use. Catholic Bishop Willie Gumbi, who led the Goma Faith Leaders Meeting on Ebola in the DRC in September 11 to 12 of 2019, said, and I quote, "We are jubilant at the marvels of medical science in finding a vaccine to cure this deadly disease. But a cure brings no hope if fearful people have no trust in their health systems administering the drug. He offered the Catholic Church help to persuade citizens to accept the vaccines that have been developed." Now, the natural institution, and I say this in front of my colleague John Kingsagon, the natural institution to build community-based trust networks is the Africa Center for Disease Control. It is, in my view, the most promising agency of the African Union, run by professionals with drive and vision. Its regional coordinating centers, there are five on the continent, are ideal intermediaries between local bodies and continent-wide networks. The RCCs are to become fully-fledged regional public health institutes in the course of time. African parliaments must move rapidly and create their own national public health institutes on which the RCCs can build. But being a former member of the South African Parliament, I can tell you, those parliaments are very slow, like many other parliaments. When I was in I left Parliament in 2017, and we looked at the first NAPISA bill, the National Public Health Institute of South Africa. In 2014, I was a ranking member on the committee. It is now 2020, and that bill has not been passed. So the point is that this will take long to build, and it cannot solve and cannot be expected to solve the immediate problem of the DRC. One short-term solution may be to find support for community-based non-governmental organization that includes critically the Catholic Church, which reaches more than 50% of the population in the area, in an emergency summit hosted by the United Nations and the African Union to establish peace in the region. If I can turn then to the final part of my talk, which is titled A New Species of Trouble. Oh, I didn't show this one. That was a distribution of the health security index when it comes to political and security risks. And you can see where the most vulnerable parts of the world are. So it's largely around it's North Africa, that's Libya, and then in West Africa, where Boko Haram operates out of, Central Africa and East Africa. And you can see the other highlighted areas, Ukraine, Afghanistan and Pakistan, and that's Venezuela. So, A New Species of Trouble was a wonderful book published by a Yale University sociology professor. And the subtitle of this book is The Human Experience of Modern Disasters. Kai Erickson had conducted research about the people who thought that they had been damaged by five catastrophic events. And his job was to prepare research-based briefs and to appear in court on their behalf in order to give testimony in what was a long series of litigation efforts. As he recounted, the catastrophic events were a valley in West Virginia known as Buffalo Creek, devastated by a fearsome flood, an Ojibwa Indian reserve in Canada called Grassy Narrows, which was plagued by contamination of the waterways along which members of the band had lived for centuries, a town in South Florida named Immokalee, where 300 farm workers were robbed of the only money most of them had ever saved, a group of houses in Colorado known as East Swallow, threatened by vapors from silent pools of gasoline that had gathered in the ground below, and the neighborhood surrounding Three Mile Island. Erickson called these catastrophic events a new species of trouble, a flood, an act of larceny, toxic poisoning, a gasoline spill, and a nuclear accident, because the 1990s were seen as the beginning of the end of the old species of trouble, which is infectious diseases. And this was marked, as you may recall, by the very confident 1988 WHO declaration of intent to eradicate polio worldwide. It was the end of what I think the high point in modernism, which is a profoundly important contribution vaccines made to the elimination and the reduction of infectious diseases. Erickson was part of an intellectual community that formulated the widely held epidemiological transition theory, predicting a shift from infectious diseases to non-communicable diseases based on the belief that infectious diseases could be reined in, even eradicated, the end, therefore, of the old species belonging to the past. But as Juliet Bedford, Jeremy Farrar, Chikwe Ikwezu, Gagandeep Kang, Marion Koopmans, and John Kenzagong point out in their recent 2019 article in Nature magazine, current demographic transitions driven by globalization, by climate change, and political instability have fundamentally altered the dynamics of infectious disease outbreaks in both developing countries as well as developed countries, fueling as a consequence more complex epidemics. More than that, recent technological developments have given us the tools to genetically modify pathogens and to design synthetic ones de novo, creating an altogether new species of trouble against which we have little defense. Alert to the risk, the Nuclear Threat Initiative started the Global Biosecurity Dialogue to catalyze global efforts to minimize the risks and to begin to manage the hazards associated with biosecurity gaps. The index included biosecurity assessment categories that measured four areas of concern by asking whether countries had systems to do the following: Firstly, to keep dangerous pathogens in secure hands, this is biosecurity. Secondly, to protect health workers from being infected by dangerous pathogens, biosafety. Thirdly, to build a culture of responsible science and have oversight of what is known as dual-use research, either from done for military purpose or peaceful applications, but typically the reverse today, for peaceful purposes, with possible terrorist applications. And what it did was, and fourthly, I'm sorry, to screen synthesized DNA, deoxyribonucleic acid, against lists prior to sale. It's the fourth measure. This was assembled into a single biosecurity score. The results for the 195 countries indicate, as a result, how much work lies ahead. 81% of countries score in the bottom tier for indicators related to accidental risks. Yeah, essentially three tiers. So bottom tier, middle tier, and the top tier. 66% score in the bottom tier for indicators related to accidental risks. Fewer than 5% of countries provide oversight for dual-use research. Not a single country has legislation or regulations that require companies to screen a synthesized DNA. And fifthly, 92% of countries do not show evidence of requiring security checks for personnel with access to dangerous biological materials or to toxins. The biosecurity gaps are displayed in the heat maps, the illustrations, and tables I will now share with you. First on a global level, then by WHO region, and then in the most vulnerable part of the world, by Africa CDC region. I will also spend time focusing on the USA to highlight the challenges here. So let me take you through the slide. So this score is essentially the preparedness score when it comes to biological risks. And yellow means that you're in the top tier, brown in the middle tier, and red in the bottom tier. So that's the overall distribution in the world when it comes to preparedness, dealing with protection devices against pathogens. This is the biosecurity measure, which you can see covers, the red covers all of Africa, into the Middle East, portions of East Europe, and also on the left-hand side, the western part of South America into Central America. I must say that biosecurity is a new issue, and this in part is not a surprise. And if you add up the red areas and the brown areas, you can see that most of the world is simply not ready to take this on. So what it does, it identifies the gaps, and it tells us how far we have to go. So that's biosecurity. Biosafety looks a little better, but not much better. This is when it comes to the culture of responsible science and oversight over dual-use research. And you can see that except for the US, and there's one country over there, and to the right of Italy, that is also in that same band, but that the globe, in fact, is covered in red. So that the world is simply not ready to have oversight over dual-use research and the development of a culture of responsible science. If we go by WHO region, that is what the Americas look like on those three scores. This is the European region. That is the Eastern Mediterranean region. And that is the WHO Africa region. If you go by Africa, the CDC RCC distribution. Oh, I'm sorry, and that's the Southeast Asia region as well. This is the Southern Africa RCC. My own country is not doing very well, but it's doing better on the biosafety together with Angola levels. That's Western, at a Central Africa RCC, Eastern Africa RCC, and the Northern Africa RCC. So it's all red, pretty much, on most fronts. Now, the risks associated with technological, biotechnological innovation are recent, and that is why the heat maps are overwhelmingly red. The speed of innovation, as you know, the people who work in this area is brisk. So there, in fact, there's not a lot of time to close the gaps that has been identified in the index. The data shared here indicate gaps on a national level. The next step is to assess the gaps on the laboratory level and also the transportation of the logistics of it. And so all countries, if they haven't yet started, must almost immediately begin to initiate biosecurity audits of the laboratories and transportation logistics and begin to frame interventions to upscale appropriate bioprotection systems and procedures, especially in facilities that work with infectious agents. There's nothing stopping laboratories from initiating this process, and I know of one state, New York State, that has initiated this already. But national biosecurity legislation that frames budgets may be necessary if self-governing protocols do not succeed. I wanted to spend a little bit of time on the US. And you can see that when it comes to biosecurity, biosafety, it scores 100. When it comes to dual-use research and a culture of responsibility, the score sits at 50. And when it comes to biosecurity, to 89.3. So the United States came out best in the overall Global Health Security Index. It came out second best when it comes to biosecurity. But this illustrates what the gaps are still. If we look a bit more closely at the numbers, this is broken down by those three categories: biosecurity, biosafety, and dual-use research. I've highlighted where the gaps are. When it comes to whole of government biosecurity system, the score is at 80, should be 100. When it comes to the consolidation of especially dangerous pathogens into a minimum number of facilities, which is a general rule of thumb, score of a 0 for that. So that's a red flag. When it comes to personnel vetting, that is personnel checks for permission to access especially dangerous pathogens, the score sits in the second tier at 66. Dual-use research, 50, and that should not be green, it should be red at the bottom. Screening requirements for providers of genetic material, which is 0, sitting at 0. So that identifies the gaps. You can see the rest of the scores are all sitting at 100, which is very good. But that's where the upscaling has to happen. As I said, this is on a national level, this is not on a policy level. So to conclude, let me also say that governments should consider designating a special facilitator or unit on a presidential or prime ministerial level to stay ahead of the game when it comes to high consequence risks, including those associated with new biotechnologies. In the report that I've edited titled Vital Signs, Health Security in South Africa, which will be released in the next week, we make precisely such a recommendation to South Africa's president for all the risk domains, that is including nuclear, radiological, environmental, biological, and climate-related extreme events. The Global Health Security Index calls on the Office of the United Secretary General to designate a permanent facilitator or unit for high-consequence events such as these, and I would like to amplify here how important such a recommendation is. So in sum, let me just say that these would be the recommendations: that the U.S. Security Council urgently convene a series of meetings aimed at developing rapid response capabilities, and you can see what the rest says, when it comes to outbreaks that originate in or spread to countries with high political and security risks, he should collaborate with all the appropriate bodies, in particular with national agencies and civil bodies, as I've mentioned, to broker ceasefires in high-risk areas and bring the ongoing killings and destruction of health facilities to an end. And I think what has to happen is that he will propose the holding of an emergency summit, particularly in the DRC areas with those relevant governments. Because unless that happens, that the epidemic will not burn out. And in fact, it will simply get worse. In the highest risk area of all, the Continental African Union should play an elevated and far more active leadership role in ending wars and brokering peace. The Peace and Security Division of the AU should be integrated into epidemic response to enable greater coordination between health, defense, and intelligence. So you would know that for emergency response, you need a vertical form of governance in order to effectively respond across silos. And governments tend to operate in silos. The African Union also operates in silo, and it's not a surprise. And what you require is a breaking down of the barriers, in particular between soft departments and hard departments, between health and defense and security. There should be a look at new financing mechanisms to fill preparedness gaps, and what is contained in the Global Health Security Index is a proposal to look at a system of matching funds and an expansion of the World Bank's international development allocations to include preparedness. I would like to add that there should be dedicated funding set aside to support community-based non-governmental organizations, professional associations, and leadership protection initiatives in high-risk areas, for example, like the DRC. And finally, as I mentioned, we're calling on the UN Secretary General to designate a permanent facilitator unit and to have a watching brief over and coordinating role when it comes to high-consequence events. So, ladies and gentlemen, on that note, thank you very much.
Thank you for the opportunity, and I don't have a question, but I have a comment and just a reflection after Wimot's excellent talk. And first of all, let me acknowledge Ambassador Jimmy Coker, who is here, because when in his days at HHS was instrumental in pushing forward the Africa CDC agenda, and I really want to recognize your presence here. And also recognize the strong collaboration between the Africa CDC and the NTI, which is built on trust. I'm happy that Wimot elaborated extensively on the trust factor, which is underpinning to our success to begin to respond effectively to disease threats in complex regions that we are dealing with, especially in Africa. When Beth first contacted us to collaborate, it was a big debate within the Africa CDC, and I said, I trust her. I know her, we've worked before when she was in government, and Wimot, he doesn't know this, I'm telling him for the first time, the Dean of the Medical School in Johannesburg actually said he's reliable, he's trustworthy. So we started, that was really powerful. So I think that element of trust is something that we're taking very seriously at as we develop the Africa Centers for Disease Control and Prevention, which, by the way, is a new agency that was actually established and launched by the head of states and governments of Africa following the Ebola outbreak in West Africa. There's something that disease outbreaks do to countries. I think this country itself owes its CDC, and I'd like to recognize the presence of Nancy here. I think if the historians who say 1947 malaria outbreak and the China CDC's own existence is really owed to the SARS outbreak in that period. And we now see what such a CDC can do for a continent or a country. We are now dealing with an outbreak in China, where thanks to the strong strengthening systems, including the China CDC, the situation is very dramatically different from what it was in 2002. So the Africa CDC really hopes to continue to benefit from strong and trusting collaborations like the ones that we have with the NTI, and the support that it has enjoyed from the US government / US CDC, the China CDC, the UK government, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and the World Bank recently just offered a $250 million grant for the Africa CDC. Now, to really focus on this, the conversation this afternoon on responding in challenging and insecurity conditions here, the African Union's theme this year in 2020 is silencing the guns. So the long list of countries that you saw out there are real. And unless and until we deliberately address the underlying issues of why there's so much conflict in those areas there, you cannot respond to effectively to disease outbreaks there. The current Ebola outbreak is an example. I think besides the West African outbreak, which took us a little bit longer, I mean us collectively, the world, we see what we're living in DR Congo. I think my projection is that if it continues this way by the year 2021, that is next year, we shall still be in DRC fighting this Ebola outbreak, not because we don't have the tools. We have even better tools to fight Ebola than we had in West Africa, but because largely because of the insecurity. So silencing the guns in Africa will be a key element. So the key question has to be, where are the guns coming from? And who is sustaining the guns in Africa? So it has to be a more open, broad, and courageous conversation as to what is going on in DRC, why has it been there for 20 years, and it cannot be a conversation of DRC show leadership there. I think it's broader than that, so I like your first recommendation there. Your second recommendation on the Africa Peace and Security Council, we have Africa CDC has deliberately make significant inroads into the Peace and Security Council of the African Union to the extent that they have passed a resolution recognizing public health threats as a peace and security threat for the continent. And because of that, we now have access to deployment facilities from the Peace and Security Council of the African Union. Just 2 days ago, the third briefing, an Ebola briefing, was done to the Peace and Security Council of the African Union. So we really like to end by saying that we, the Africa CDC as a young organization needs the total support from the partners, trusting support, in order to implement the roadmap you just laid out, which is the regional collaborating centers and each country to have its own national public health institution there. So thank you for the opportunity.
Thanks, sir. Is there a question over here? Okay, so back here, yeah. And also say who you are and where you're from. Is there a next?
Hi, my name is Melissa. I'm from the FEMA's CBRN office. I just had a question about your biosecurity index and the rankings. What were the metrics used to basically rack and stack the countries, and were they compared against each other in terms of, a first world country versus maybe a developing country? Or how were those numbers, were those self-reported or were those externally evaluated? Thank you.
So the goal was to establish benchmarks so that comparisons are in fact possible. And you saw that in the case of the US, the single country summary page had summary statistics, and then underneath that were the subcategories. So the numbers were collected against all of those. So I didn't collect the numbers myself. I looked and followed the project. So in terms of the technical answer to the question, I'm going to defer to Beth.
Sure.
Okay.
So it's a great question, and the actual all the methodology section for the index in total, including each question, is in the green section, color coded, of the index, which is right out in the lobby. So for those that are interested in actually looking at any of the metrics, they're all there. Every country was graded the same way with the same questions. and recognizing that there's definitely, for things like dual use research, there are countries doing more risky research, there are countries doing less research with pathogens that have pandemic potential. We thought it was important to set a high bar, especially while the bioeconomy around the world is growing. So we recognized that that was a tough bar for that piece. We looked across many different pieces of biosecurity. So we looked at laboratory biosecurity, we looked at transport security for samples, we looked at dual use research oversight. It's a wide swath of things that would fall into biosecurity. And we define biosecurity as the risk that of deliberate use. So biosecurity, the likelihood that theft could happen or that an agent could be misused deliberately. And biosafety, we looked at accidental risk.
And was that self-reported from the countries, or was that an external
Yeah, so an external entity gathered the data, and our partner on this, in addition to NTI and the Johns Hopkins Center for Health Security, was the Economist Intelligence Unit, EIU. They're the research arm of the Economist magazine. They build indices, and they have a methodology for gathering research. Most of the researchers were in the actual countries reading, mostly reading governmental documents, reading, online documents, policies, legislation, and also some academic literature, so gathered by them. Countries were given a chance to validate their scores. Not surprisingly, for a first index, not that many countries chose to do that.
I just want to note that there are copies of the index out here that you could look and get it and get the methodology. Also, just note that this has followed a longstanding effort at NTI called a nuclear security index. So there's been a lot of practice with the Economist Intelligence Unit in doing that. And finally, the comment I'd make is, correct me if I'm wrong, either of you, but as I recall, a weak part of the United States ranking was access to the public health system, which is not such a pleasant reality, but so be it. A question over here.
Well, you mentioned one of the key points. Access to universal access to low-cost in-network care is the first line of defense against a pandemic. This country has never been willing to do that. Access to care in that way is not a right or a privilege, with all due respect to the debate. It's a national security imperative. And President Obama and the Democrats never made that point in the debate. The ambassador spoke about how we don't know how many guns, where the guns are coming from in the Congo. We don't know where they're coming from in Chicago. So my question is, how do you envision building the political consensus to elevate some of these imperatives in public health to the policy level?
So I just put the slide back up, apropos your point. So you can see the healthcare access under the health system metric is 25.3 for the US. The global average is 38.4. So the US is not in good shape when it comes to access issues. I'm not going to comment on what's to be done in the U.S. about that policy-wise. There are better people in this room who can answer that question. I would just say that in the case of my own country, South Africa, the question of access is to improve the public health system and create a universal access insurance scheme for the country, which is where we're heading. I think that your system is obviously quite complex, and the vested interests that have come up with private medicine and how that is a barrier to universal access is something that needs to be tackled, but it's not an easy thing to do.
Do you see any good examples, even in Africa, about accomplishing that goal, moving these issues really high up in the policy level?
We just started that. Yeah, so we just started that in South Africa, is to move it up to, in fact, the presidential level, because otherwise it gets stuck in the weeds in the health system. And so you both need to get out of the silos. You need to, the departments, in the case of South Africa, to having a proper system would be health, agriculture, science and technology, environmental affairs. You probably need home affairs to deal with questions of visas. Defense and intelligence. Those are the departments. And what has to happen is that you need it to matter, so it needs to sit in the president's office. So that's what we recommend.
So you want the pandemic czar sitting in the president's office?
Yeah. High consequence risks right in the president's office. Yeah.
Hello, I'm Jennifer Mackby from Federation of American Scientists, and thank you so much for your talk. I don't think you mentioned the Biological Weapons Convention, which has been also grappling with the issues of biosafety and biosecurity. And so with your great recommendations, I'm wondering if you've approached other countries to, for example, handle the UN recommendation you suggested, and where the money will come from to deal with these recommendations. I know there's a Secretary General's mechanism, which people are working on as well. Thank you.
Yeah, so biosecurity compliance with UN resolutions is part of what needs to be done here. So it is part of the package. I attended the last BWC meeting in Geneva, and it's a very important setting. The problem is accountability on that issue, because everybody gets up and they say, congratulations to the new chair of the BWC. They also say that the members should pay up their dues. And the third is sort of a self-accounting of compliance. People listen to Russia say that we comply with most requirements. So it's something that needs much closer scrutiny and accountability over compliance. In fact, when it comes to biological and chemical weapons, needs more systematic scrutiny. And how that's to be achieved is something that the UN would have to look at quite carefully. And one of the tasks of having a facilitator or unit in the UN Secretary General's office is precisely to do that.
I think we have time for one more question, and unless there are major complaints, I'm going to ask it. One of the things that has not been really referenced in your remarks is the possibility of something from an engineered organism. Certainly in our, I alluded to this Munich tabletop we did where that was in the scenario.
Yeah.
And frankly, it really exacerbated the possibility of, again, the health people and the security people working together because of the issue of trying to resolve what's going on with who, where, again, et cetera, et cetera. Any comments on how that might be addressed? Again, especially in a complex environment.
I'm not sure how to answer that question because the hazard has to be managed in some way. So you have management systems over the hazard. But how you minimize the risk is a difficult question. Partly because the technologies have become cheaper and the ability for somebody, still with a PhD in molecular biology, I mean, you need some skill around this still, but you can also do it in a garage. And so it's decentralization in terms of location, cheaper technologies, and in some ways easier to do. And how you monitor that is not clear. And that's for me, that's a difficult challenge. So in the case of the US, they've identified about what they call biohackers, about 50 biohackers. China seems to have more biohackers. But I mean, that's a guess, So what the oversight of this research is about is begin to have compliance systems. So that's one piece. But how you track the increased risk with new technologies, which will develop rapidly, I think is a moving target. And I'm not enough of a scientist to answer that question in terms of the technical aspects. But the governance systems for that, I think it's hard to imagine what that would look like. So we're beginning to work on some pieces of the puzzle, but I can't give an overall answer.
I think there's a lot to discuss at the reception that will be happening outside, and let's thank Wilmot once again.